Hey, what's up, everybody? Welcome into this Adobe Illustrator tutorial brought to you by tutvid.com, where today we're going to take a look at this cool little sort of, interlocking circles, almost opening and closing aperture type effect. I see it used relatively often online on a lot of different artwork for different C's and G's and all kinds of different circular letters. Maybe the O could be thrown in there. And it's really an effect you can use on all kinds of different things. It's a neat little effect. We're going to cover a lot of basic to intermediate tools and techniques here in Adobe Illustrator. It's going to be pretty fast. It's going to be relatively easy to complete if you follow along closely. And if you do enjoy this video, well, may I suggest that you subscribe to this channel so you never miss any Illustrator or graphic design related tutorials in the future. Let's jump into Illustrator now and check this thing out. Okay, here we are in Adobe Illustrator. I'm going to begin this whole process with a new document. I'm going to go 2560 by 1440, and I'm rolling with CMYK color. You can get much more vibrant color with RGB, and you're probably creating this graphic for the screen, so you'd probably go with RGB. I just like working with color in CMYK, so I'm going to roll with CMYK. If you want to follow exactly everything I'm doing, including getting the exact colors that I'm getting, you should probably also follow along in CMYK. Just wanted to throw a little disclaimer out there. I'm going to create this new document, and what we're going to do is... First I'm going to open up my panel options for my layers panel, and I'm going to make these much larger, the thumbnails, that is, just a little easier for you to see. And I'm going to go ahead and grab my ellipse tool, and I'm going to begin this whole process by creating a new 600 by 600 pixel ellipse. I'm going to hit OK there. I'm going to drop the fill just so I have just a black stroke. In fact, over here in the appearance part of the properties panel, I might just bump that up to like a 5 pixel stroke. And then using my align panel here, I'm going to make sure that, number one, I'm aligning to the artboard, and then I'm just going to push this right to the center, both horizontal and vertical, just like that. Now I'm going to go ahead and create another ellipse. I'm going to click anywhere. This one's going to be 280 by 280. I'm going to hit OK. You can see it's just got the same no fill, just a black stroke. That's great. I'm going to select both of these ellipses, and I'm going to make sure, again, I'm just aligning to the artboard, so we're going to just throw these to the middle, just like that. Center them up just perfectly. Now what we need to do is create an ellipse. This is going to require a little bit of both geometry and math. I guess geometry is a little mathy in and of itself, but we want to create an ellipse that is the radius of the outer circle plus the radius of the inner circle. So the radius, as I'm sure you are very well aware of, is half the diameter, and the diameter is the straight across width of a circle. So remember, this was 600 by 600. So our radius of this circle is going to be from this point to this point, which is 300 pixels. And then for our little guy here in the middle, it's 280. So basically, it's just 280 divided by 2, which is what, 140. So 300 plus 140 is 440 pixels. It's important that you kind of remember that little equation, because it allows us to get the proper sized ellipses here. So I'm going to click with my ellipse tool, and I'm going to create a 440 by 440 ellipse. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to align it to the center and bottom of my large ellipse. Here's how I'm going to do that. I'm going to select both of those ellipses, not the little center ellipse. See how that's not selected? Over here in the align panel, I'm going to choose to align to key object. Now what I need to do is click on the shape that I want to be the key object. In this case, the key object is the shape that is going to be aligned against, if that makes any sense. So if I set the large ellipse to be my key object, that's not going to be moved. We're going to move the second ellipse with respect to that initial ellipse. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to say, look, align this to the bottom and also to the horizontal center, just like that. And now I can deselect. Now what I'll do, I'll select those two ellipses again. I guess I really didn't have to deselect. Hold down shift, and I'm going to drag this clockwise, just like that. It's going to rotate that ellipse 45 degrees, looking good, just like so. Now basically we're going to repeat that process. You could, I guess, duplicate this ellipse. So I'm going to select that, hold down alter option, duplicate it out here, and just let it go. And whoop, I didn't hold down alter option. You want to make sure you hold down alter option to actually create a duplicate like that. And then hold down shift and just select that larger outer ellipse again. Once more, we're going to align to key object. We're going to click onto that larger ellipse. We want that to be the key object. We're going to go align horizontally and then to the bottom middle. And now we're going to hold down shift, and we are going to rotate this the other direction. So I'm just going to hold down shift and click it once, sort of counterclockwise, just like so. So we're getting most of the shapes we need. We need one more shape here, and that's going to be a straight up rectangle. And I'm going to click once, and I'm going to ignore the strange sounds coming out of my computer. I'm going to go 360 by 360 for the rectangle, hence making it a square. I'm going to drag it over, and I'm going to hold down shift, and I'm just going to rotate it so it's more like a diamond. Now, this is where I like to turn my smart guides on. So I'm going to go view, make sure the smart guides are turned on, because what I want to do is I want this leftmost point to align with the very center of my circle. So I can just drag this over, and you'll see, thanks to smart guides, that'll snap right into place just like so. All right, so now what I'm going to do, I'm going to select all these shapes, and we're going to swap stroke and fill. So now we just have what's going to essentially look like a big black blob. And maybe to make this easier, I'll go to Outline mode here under View Outline. You can see we still have all of our paths, and we can even select them and work with them. So here's what I want to do. First and foremost, I want to select the outermost circle and the innermost circle. So I'm going to make sure I hover over it. And I can't, oh no, there we go. I almost just got it there. There we go. And I'm going to go to my Pathfinder panel and I'm going to choose to minus front. So that's going to use that central circle. And as you can see here in our transparency panel, just punch a hole and create sort of this donut shape for us. Now, if I get out of outline mode, we're still not going to see that because we have these other circles that are kind of covering that up. So I'm going to enter back into outline mode. And here what I'll do, the same thing with now my now donut shape and the square. So I'm going to shift select both of them. And I'm going to choose to minus front here as well. And you can see this is giving us this sort of C shape. Very cool. But we still have these other odd looking circular shapes that we need to do something with. We need to clean this up and complete this effect. All I want to do is select all of these shapes and use the divide Pathfinder feature. So I'm going to divide it. They're going to be grouped up here if I look within my layer. So there's the group. I'm going to ungroup them, Command Shift G. And really, because it's ungrouped, I can select the stuff I know I don't need, like this shape here. I think I don't need that. I can probably delete that. I can look at what's going on there, that open thing in the middle. I don't need that. And now it's going to be a process of selecting shapes here and kind of rebuilding the bits that I want. So I know I want this little piece of the path to be merged with this shape. So I can select both of those and I can just go ahead and hit the merge option. There we go. We've got that sort of stripe of our letter C. And then underneath here, let's see, can I select both of these shapes? Maybe it'll be easier. Let me collapse my properties panel real quick. Maybe we can select them here in our panel. Where's this? Okay, so that's got to be a part of this inner shape. Down there, that's also part of the shape. So let's just shift click both of those. And then I think it's this big piece here that we need. Yeah, it's that big piece. Let's try merging all these together. There we go, we have that. Oh, I think we probably should have selected that little piece as well. Let's try merging all those together. And what I'm gonna do in fact here is just hit this unite option that you can see is gonna give us one big old shape like that. That's cool. And then I can select these remaining two pieces right there. We can go ahead and merge those together and we don't need to do any kind of uniting. And we have these three shapes. Now, if I get out of outline view, you can see that it still looks like we just have three, really nothing. We don't see the three shapes. That's part of the problem. We have just one big black letter C. And I want to change that. So what I want to do here is select the topmost shape. I'm going to go to my CMYK viewing option, and I'm going to set the K value to 0. I'm going to set cyan to 100, and I'm also going to set magenta to 100. So it's kind of this, what is that, kind of a bluish purpley color. I have a difficult time seeing blues and purples, but it should be that based upon the CMYK options that we dialed in. Here we're going to set K to 0. We're going to boost cyan to like 65 and once more magenta up to 100. This should be a little bit more purpley than the bluish, more bluish color above it. And then here for our final color, I think this should probably be the darkest of all the colors. Let's set the K to 0% as well. We're going to go once more 100 in terms of the magenta. And I think I want to pop a little yellow in there as well, just to kind of enrich that magenta a little bit. So it's three, at least in my eyes, very, very similar colors, but still each with their own unique differences. Now what I'm going to do, I'm just going to restack my layers so that they kind of work exactly like the graphic looks. See, this is the top piece, there's the middle piece, there's the bottom piece. I'm going to select these three objects. I'm going to copy and paste them in place. So we'll go edit, copy, and then we'll choose edit, paste in front. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to fill them, all three of them. I'm going to keep all three selected to make this easier. We're going to go gradient, and we're going to fill them with a black to transparent gradient. So what I'll do here is I'll drag the black slider out, click somewhere behind the black slider to just, you know, include the black. In fact, I'm going to set this to full CMYK, and we're just going to set all of our sliders to 100%, and I will select the other handle, and I'll just do the same thing. I probably should have done this before I duplicated it, but hey, you know what? Hindsight is 2020. There we go. That's great. And now I can just drag the white slider, get that out of there, drag the black slider all the way over to the other side. I'm going to select the rightmost slider, and I'm going to set the opacity of it to 0%. So we now have three black to transparent gradients. We can work with them all individually because they're all on their own layer. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to select the topmost gradient first. I'll grab the gradient tool here. It might be an easier way to work with this. And I'm going to shift the gradient off to the side, maybe kind of just like that. I can go to the Pathfinder panel. We want to go to the transparency panel, which I have down here. We can try setting this to like multiply. It's not really going to make much of a difference for us because we just have black to black transparent. What I will do is use my opacity and maybe knock this down to like 50%, something like that. We'll come back and adjust transparencies if we need, but I'm going to try to just kind of, I don't know, just freehand hand it, see what we get here. Now I'm going to come over to this path, and in this case, we want the darkest part of our shadow to be up there. So I'm going to rotate my gradient around, and let's just kind of adjust and adjust, and maybe stretch the gradient out a little bit, adjust a little bit more, and I'm going to try setting the transparency here to maybe like 70%, because that should really be probably the darkest part of the image, because it's sort of like the top of the C should be casting a shadow, if you will, right there on that part of the graphic. All right, let's select the bottommost gradient right there. I'm going to grab my gradient tool, and in this case, the gradient's kind of where we want it to be. Let's just back it off a little bit. Maybe we'll rotate it a little, kind of something like that. I'll push it back a little, and then we can set the opacity. I don't know, let's try like 65%, something like that. Let me try typing in 65 again. Sometimes I have a difficult time with numbers. There we go. So just like that, we got kind of some nice subtle shadowing that we have on our letter. And of course, you can go with any colors you want. I'm just picking these like blues and purples and pinks because I think they look kind of neat. And now what I want to do is I want to select the middle shape. So I'm going to select it here in the layers panel. I'm going to copy by going edit, copy. And by the way, I'm selecting it in the layers panel because I want to select the fill colored shape, not the gradient one. So I'm going to go edit, copy, and then I'm going to choose paste in front, and I will have to go object, arrange, and I'm going to say, look, bring this guy all the way to the front. So you can see it's all the way up in the front, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to max it out, fill it with white, and I'm thinking about that wrong. I want to slide everything back. There we go. 0% across the board is in fact white. I like to live in the CMYK world, but sometimes I'm still thinking in RGB. All right, so we've got this shape. Basically, what I want to try to do here is go object path and choose to offset this path. And I want to offset it. I'm going to preview this, by the way. I want to offset this. Probably about 10 pixels will work. But what I'm looking for here is I don't like how it just suddenly ends right there. I want it to continue on. So I'm going to change the miter limit here until I'm getting something that I like. So essentially, I want this to be very pointy on the edge. Now, this needs to be very pointy. It needs to come out pretty far. So a miter limit of like 200 might work. There we go. 200 is going to work. Can we go a little shorter than that? Let's try 175. 175 would work. Will 150 work? 150 will work too. I think we'll ride with 150 there. I think that works for me. That just allows the shape to really continue out. And we're going to trim it off. So that doesn't matter. I just want it to continue out if I want that option. We may end up masking it away. I don't know yet. We'll see. Next, what I want to do, and by the way, ignore this purple shape here in the middle. It does have a gradient. It's just sometimes Illustrator doesn't preview things correctly. What I have here is the original size shape and our new shape. I can select the original size shape and just delete it. We don't need that at all. And this new shape, we're going to create a mask here I'll show you what we're going to do. We're going to create a mask though. What I want to do is select the topmost shape, just like that, and also the bottommost shape by holding down shift and selecting that as well. So you can see I've selected this bottom like magenta pink shape and the top more blue, cyan, but I think it's more bluish shape, and I'm going to copy them. So I'm going to go edit, and I'm going to choose copy. And now I'm going to select my top layer here. In fact, I'll rename this layer stroke because that's exactly what we're going to get here. I'm going to go to my transparency panel and I'm going to double click here on this thumbnail, which is going to give me an opacity mask. You can see it filled with black. That's actually perfect. We're going to go edit, paste in front to paste those shapes back in. I think I'm just going to fill this with solid white. So I'll come over here to my color panel. I'll say, look, give me solid white. You can see we're getting these two interesting stroke effects on the edges of our color. Now, if we really wanted to take this effect a little bit further, well, first and foremost, we'll probably go and set this layer to the blend mode of overlay, or really it's the shape to overlay. I'm sorry, I should be out of my layer mask, hit the artwork layer again. Let's go and set this to overlay. You can see, there we go, we're getting this type of effect. And we could even reduce the opacity a little bit if we like. I don't think I'm going to reduce the opacity though. I think what I'm going to do is give it the same black to transparent gradient and see what we can get. So I'm going to select stroke. I'm going to select those shapes and I'm just going to hit the black to transparent gradient. It's going to give it that fill. You can see we've got some weirdness going on here because it's going to make our entire little stroke go away. But I'm going to use the gradient tool. I'm going to redraw this because I just want the black to maybe appear up here. And of course, if I was thinking straight, I don't want black at all. I want these to be solid white. So I'm going to go, look, give me solid white. And I'm going to select the other black. I'm going to say, give me solid white. And let's try this with this gradient. So what we'll do is we'll stretch this out a little bit. Actually, I want to flip this around because I want the bulk of the white to be over here. So you can see basically what's happening is the gradient is beginning at this stop right here, the far left stop. And that's where it's saying, look, we're going to go from solid white where everything's going to be showing and just begin at this point to fade it out And by fading it out, we basically get, you know, solid black. And what it's going to do is just take our stroke and it's full strength, and then it kind of fades off to nothing. So we probably, in the end, didn't need to do that little miter effect, but it's a cool thing to know how to do. So we did it anyway. All right, so now that we have the gradient created, I can just select this bottom shape. I can grab my eyedropper tool, say, give me that white gradient that I have up there. And then I can use the gradient tool here, and I can just tweak and adjust this as well as I see fit. Maybe what I'll do here, actually spin this gradient around. And we'll just kind of fade. Whoop, let me try this again. Let me just draw the gradient this way. And my idea would be just kind of fade the little shape here as we enter sort of the center part of the C, just like that. Great. And I will deselect that. And then what I'll do is down here in the transparency panel to get out of the mask, I'll just select the return to normal editing mode thumbnail right there. And you can see that we've just added that kind of cool little accenting stroke there. And without it, it just, the artwork looks very flat. But once you throw it in there, it looks pretty stinking cool. And maybe last but not least, what we'll do, we'll just lock up this layer and I'll create a new layer and I'll drag this down beneath. And we'll grab our rectangle tool, we'll click a single time, we'll go 2560 by 1440, which is the size of our document. And I'm going to use the align panel. I'm going to say, yeah, align this horizontally, vertically, all that good stuff. And then here with CMYK, maybe we'll boost cyan and magenta to 100% and then just really darken this to give ourselves a nice deep, very blue, purple, whatever it is, type background that really just gives us a nice popping contrast for this shape. You can throw a little shadow or glow under or behind it, something like that, if you're really feeling risky. But this is essentially how you can create these kind of spiraling, think open aperture type graphics here in Adobe Illustrator. And then, of course, we put a little English on it in terms of the stroke edges and the background and all that fun stuff. But this here is how you create this effect in Adobe Illustrator. Ah, yes, well, there you have it. That is the little effect. If you do complete this tutorial, I'd love to see it. Upload your design to Instagram. Tag me in the Instagram post. My Instagram handle is @tutvid. I'd love to see you over there on Instagram. We also have a community that we're building over on Discord, discord.me/tutvid. That's what it is. There's a link down in the bio where you don't have to rely on my remembering of URLs here. You can just go click that and join us over there on Discord as well. So for all these different effects here in Adobe Illustrator using shapes and colors, gradients, offsetting of paths, and everything that we covered in this video tutorial, ladies and gentlemen, that's it. Get it? Got it? Good. With Daniel Dodson, tutvid.com. I'll catch you in the next one.
And before you go, make sure you subscribe to my channel for more great tutorials every day. Also, buy my course. It helps us do what we do, and this channel is supported by viewers just like you. You can also just click the thumbnail and watch another video from this channel. See you next time, guys.